1, 2, 3, 10.
Hello everyone. Today I am going to start a new topic, that is types of receptor. In the previous video I have already explained what are the receptors, and I have to explain in details what are the different types of receptors. So see, I'll start with the basic idea of the receptor first. Receptors as such, they are present either on the cell membranes or they may be present in the nucleus. So basically they can be considered as cytoplasmic or nuclear receptor, but the concept of receptor was first time given by John Langley in 1878, but still he has given the term that receptive substances. But the details of the concept of receptor was given by Paul Ehrlich, and he said that receptors are located on the membrane and they are responding to the signal molecules, and hence signal transduction process occurs. There are two types of receptor, as I already told you. One is internal receptor and second is cell surface receptor. Internal receptors are present inside the cell, that is, they may be nuclear receptor or cytoplasmic, and cell surface receptor are located on cell membrane. In this diagram, I have shown that several types of ligand molecules or signal molecules are present, and they are going to bind with the particular receptors. It means all the ligands are very specific for the particular receptors. Details of all these things I have explained in the previous video. So let us continue with the types of receptor. Internal or intracellular receptors are those receptors which are present inside the cell. As I explained in the diagram, you can see that signal molecules which are diffusible, such as hydrophobic molecules or gaseous molecule, they enter directly inside the cell, they bind to their specific receptors, and finally they are responsible for the particular biological responses. Cell surface receptors are present on the cell membrane and they are responding to the hydrophilic molecules. They perform signal transduction via certain type of changes occurs in the receptors, and they are responsible for the activation of secondary messengers. There are three main components of the cell surface receptor. First component, that is external ligand binding domain, that is extracellular domains. These domains are located outside the cell, so it is known as external domain. Second is hydrophobic membrane spanning domain. Why it is hydrophobic in nature? You should know that plasma membrane are basically made up of lipid with certain proteins. So since plasma membrane is mainly made up of lipid, whatever the receptors are present on that time, it means when receptor will going to pass through this lipid, they are not able to interact with the lipid, and that's why the nature of this amino acid which are embedded in the plasma membrane, they should be hydrophobic, and that's why it is written here that a hydrophobic membrane spanning region. Third is an intracellular domain inside the cell. It is located inside the cell, and generally secondary messengers are going to bind or somehow activated by this intracellular domains also. I have given certain examples here of intracellular domains, that is ligand gated ion channel, G protein coupled receptor, receptor tyrosine kinase, integrins, as well as toll like receptors. See in details. First one is gated ion channels. Gated ion channels are those type of channels which are located on plasma membrane, and they are basically responsible for the passing of ions. The gate is usually closed, but once either voltage are generated or certain type of neurotransmitter will bind to that particular area, then this gated ion channel will be open. I'll explain later on again what is gated ion channel and how it is working in details. Second is receptor enzyme or plasma membrane receptors. One of the famous example of this receptor is insulin receptors. As we know nowadays that insulin is playing very important role to maintain the glucose level in our body, they belong to the receptor enzyme plasma membrane, or it is also known as plasma membrane receptors. See here, try to understand that receptor enzyme, it means receptor is itself acting as enzyme. So once these receptors are having enzymatic activity, they are known as receptor enzyme or plasma membrane receptors. Third is known as receptor protein or serpentine receptors. This is different from receptor enzyme in the sense that these receptors are not enzymatic. It means these serpentine receptors are responding to the ligands. These ligands are binded and are actually attached with the G proteins. Now G protein will activate enzymes which are not part of this receptor, these enzymes are present on certain other location. So in short, I can say receptor enzymes are already receptor having enzymatic activity, but serpentine receptors are not having enzymatic activity, but they indirectly activate certain enzyme binded with plasma membrane. Fourth is nuclear receptors. These nuclear receptors are also famous with the name of steroids receptor, because steroids are able to cross and they are able to bind to the nuclear receptors. One of the famous example is different type of steroids. These receptors are present either on the nuclear membrane or they are present in the cytoplasm. Then fifth is receptors with no enzymatic activity. This receptors is different from other receptor in the sense that these receptors are also having no enzyme activity. It means they are somehow matching with the serpentine receptor, but there is a great difference. In serpentine receptors, these receptors are binded with the G protein, and serpentine receptors are indirectly activating enzymes that was binded with the cell membrane. Here, in receptor with no enzymatic activity, that the best example is JAK-STAT pathway. Once ligand will bind to the receptors, these receptors are activated, and the enzymes which is present in the cytoplasm, these enzymes will bind to the receptor and they activate. For the details I will explain later on, but still in this example I will say that JAK is a receptor which are present on the cell membrane, and STAT is a separate enzymatic activity protein. So it means it's a protein having enzymatic activity. They are present in the cytoplasm. Once JAK are activated, STAT will bind to the JAK and they become activated and they convey the masses. As I already told you that we have to see in details what are the gated ion channels. Gated ion channels are present on the plasma membrane. They may open or they may close, depend on situations. So one of the diagram I have shown here, when messengers are not present, this gated ion channel is closed. But once messengers will bind, these channels will be open. There are three steps for this working of gated ion channel. Step number one, ligand bind to receptors. Step two, certain type of conformational changes occurs in the receptors. And third, ions will be able to cross through this ion channels. In the diagram, you can see receptors. The receptors are present, but ligand is not binded. Once ligand is binded, in the next diagram you can see, once ligand is binded, some conformational changes occurs. Now gate is open and ions are able to cross. Again, these are two types. They may be ligand gated or they may be voltage gated. First, ligand gated ion channel. As the name suggests, those type of gated ion channel which are activated by binding with the ligands, they are known as ligand gated ion channels. They are also known as inotropic receptors. These are receptors which are responding to neurotransmitters mainly. One of the famous example is acetylcholine receptors. They are responding to the neuronal system, which you have shown in my previous video. The time scale is milliseconds. They are working very fastly, and they are located on membrane only. The effector molecule is ion channels, and the example is nicotine, acetylcholine receptor, GABA, glycine, then 5-HT3, then glutamate. Several type of examples are present. Now, next is see molecular structure of nicotine. Try to understand. This nicotine acetylcholine receptor, they are very important, and in several examination, the questions are deeply asked with the nicotine acetylcholine receptor. So I have given one emphasis on the nicotinic acetylcholine receptor separately. They are pentameric receptors, and they are made up of four subunits, alpha, beta, gamma, delta. There are two alpha, one beta, one gamma, and one delta. They are having acetylcholine binding regions, and there are certain regions where these receptors are actually, the gate is actually closed. Once acetylcholine, since there are two acetylcholine binding region, once two acetylcholine will simultaneously bind on this particular receptors, this becomes open, and then ion channel will be open. There are certain type of kink or twist occurs, and these ion channels becomes open and ions are able to cross. Now, second type of gated ion channel is voltage gated ion channel. They are, as the name suggests, they are basically dependent on voltage, and obviously it is related to the neurons mainly. So once voltage is generated, then due to this voltage, there are certain type of depolarization occurs, and due to depolarization, these channels are opened. As you have already gone through voltage ion channel, that is, if you remember, that sodium potassium, sodium ion channel, then potassium ion channel, then sodium potassium pump, they all are the best example of voltage gated channel. The mechanism is same, which I have explained earlier with that ligand gated. The only thing is, here ligand is not binded, they are responding to the particular level of voltage. Then next and very important receptor is G protein coupled receptor. Let me first tell you, you have to study G protein coupled receptor separately, and you have to see in details. But here I have given certain basic things of the G protein coupled receptor. The first thing is, the Goodman, Gilman and Martin Rodbell, in 1994 they discovered G protein coupled receptor. From 1994 to till date, there are several families of the G protein coupled receptor has been observed, and it is considered as the largest family. Location is plasma membrane, and they are coupled with the G protein. Now see, they are generally single polypeptide chain having 1100 residue, and they are also famous with the name of 7 pass or 7 transmembrane receptors. 7 transmembrane, it means 7 times they are able to cross the membrane, and that's why this is known as 7 transmembrane or 7 pass. It has extracellular N region and intracellular C region. It means N-terminal region or domain are present on the outside of the cell, and C-terminal domain is present inside the cell. Best example is adrenoreceptors. Besides this, adrenoreceptor is for epinephrine. Then other example is muscarinic, then histamine, serotonin, opioid, cannabinoids, peptide, amine. If you know that opioid and cannabinoid, these are different type of drugs, and these drugs are actually bind to this receptor. So most of the drugs are binded to these receptors, and they are responding particularly for the different biological responses. There are two part of G protein coupled receptor. One, a plasma membrane receptors with 7 transmembrane alpha helical helical segments. In the diagram, you can see epinephrine bind to the specific receptor where NS3 and CO is present. It is passed 7 times. So if you count, it will be 7, and that's why these are known as 7 transmembrane. Then second part is guanosine nucleotide, that is G protein, which is binded in the intracellular region with the receptors. So see, the first one, that is plasma membrane receptors, and second one, that is G protein. Now the working principle is same here. In the working principle, usually G protein is already binded to the receptor, but they are inactive. For the activation, ligands must be required to bind to the receptor. When ligand bind to the receptor activated, and after activation, now G protein are having dual activity. G protein is inactive once they are binded with the GDP, and they are active if they are binded with the GTP. So remember, until and unless ligand is not going to bind to the receptor, this G protein is inactive, that is their GDP. But once ligand will bind to the receptors, after binding, certain type of conformational changes occurs, and then GDP will be exchanged with the GTP. That's why now GTP is now binded with the G protein. G protein is made up of GS alpha, beta and gamma, but this GTP is mainly bind with the GS alpha. And now it becomes activated and biological responses occurs. What are the different type of biological responses? That I will explain later in the details of the G protein coupled receptors. So now come to the next receptor, third one, that is adrenergic receptor. This adrenergic receptor is a part of G protein coupled receptor, but it is a very famous example. Nowadays most of the drugs are based on these receptors only. This adrenergic receptor differs in their affinity and response to a group of agonist and antagonist. This term is very famous nowadays in the drug discovery. See, as you know that ligand when bind to the receptors, transduction occurs, biological responses occurs. Agonists are structural analog. Structural analog means they are structurally similar to the signal molecules epinephrine, and hence once they are able to bind to receptor, biological responses occurs. So one say for example, in a body, in bodies sometimes this ligands need to be required in the huge amount, but ligands are not produced in the huge amount because of feedback responses. So people's doctors are referring drugs. These drugs are nothing, they are agonist. These agonist will be similar with the signal molecule in the structure, and hence they are able to bind to the receptor. So it is mimicking, basically agonists are mimicking the natural signal molecules, and they are responsible for the continuation of signal transduction pathway. One of the best examples shown here, that is isoproterenol. They are similar with the epinephrine. See, this is a very important drug for the asthma therapy. So for the asthma patient, this epinephrine is required in huge amount, but epinephrine is not produced in huge amount. So that's why isoproterenol are provided, and these are working efficiently similar with, and they are very similar with the epinephrine. So it is acting as a drug. And second very contrasting type of word is present that are known as antagonist. Antagonist is just reverse of agonist, but it doesn't mean it is bad. It is also very good. Sometimes what happens that if any signal transduction pathways do not requiring, but it is occurring, it means, say for example, once ligand molecule bind to receptor, and due to this receptor transduction occurs, but we do not require such type of responses because it is not good for our health for a particular, any particular situation. So again, there are structurally similar molecule are designed, but this structurally similar molecules are having some specificity, but they are differed from epinephrine in such a way that they can bind to the receptor, but they do not activate receptor. Now try to understand, agonist can bind to receptor, but they activate receptor and transduction occurs. Agonist can bind to receptor, but they do not activate receptors, and hence signal transduction pathway do not affect, and hence it can block the effect of agonist. One of the best example is propranolol, and this is good for controlling heartbeat. So this is one of the drug. So they are having agonist and antagonist, both are important, but at different time periods. Now come to the enzyme linked and related receptors. They are working a little bit slow, work in hours, location is membrane, and the effector molecule is basically protein kinase. It means the kinase molecule will bind it with the receptors. Receptor itself have kinase activity. They are single membrane spanning helical region. The previous one, G protein coupled receptors are serpentine. It means 7 times it was binded, but enzyme linked receptors are single membrane spanning helical region. This best example of this family is insulin, then growth factor, cytokines, as well as ANF, that is antinatriuretic factor receptors. For this transduction pathway, you can see the example. There are two different type of receptors shown here. When ligand will bind to the receptors, they will dimerize. As I already explained in the previous video, that dimerization or integration occurs, and then finally after dimerization they are phosphorylating. Here in this example you can see that tyrosine molecules are present. 3 tyrosine molecules are present in one receptor, 3 tyrosine molecules are present in other receptors. They are autophosphorylating, phosphorylate each other, and finally they are responsible for the pathway. There are several important pathway related to the enzyme linked and related receptors, but the two are famous. One is RAS, which you have to study separately. RAS, RAF or MAP kinase pathway, this is that is responsible for the cell division, growth and differentiation. And second is JAK-STAT pathway. JAK-STAT pathway, as they are responsible for certain type of immunological response, they are mainly related to the cytokines, and they are related to inflammatory mediators. I'll explain later on about the details of the JAK-STAT pathway also. Then the last one is nuclear receptors. As I already explained, the very less study has been done in the nuclear receptors. The time scale is hours, location is intracellular, the effector molecule is this gene transcription, and once this molecule will be enter, after entering they bind to the nuclear receptors. These nuclear receptors will directly enter into the cell, into the nucleus. In the nucleus, some hormone responsing elements are present. Now receptor will directly activate hormone responsing, activate the hormone responsing element, which is acting as a transcriptional factor. Transcription occurs, then translation occurs, and finally biological activity occurs. So this is overall about the different type of receptors. In the further lectures, I'll explain G protein coupled receptor, enzyme receptor, MAP kinase, as well as JAK-STAT pathway in details. For now, I'm going to stop here, and later on I will explain about all these receptors separately. Thank you.